Hi, everyone. My name is Prajakta Atsol, and I am an assistant professor at the University of New Mexico. Today, I'll be talking to you about implementation strategies. As an overview of my talk, we'll cover what do we mean by implementation strategies. In some cases, how are they selected? Or in other cases, how are they developed? We'll also talk about how to report and track implementation strategies and some methods that have been shown in previous research. We'll also consider some future research questions for the field of implementation strategies as a whole. So as you've learned in implementation science, the goal is to develop effective strategies for implementing evidence-based practices. We intend to produce generalizable knowledge regarding these selected strategies by understanding the different processes or barriers and facilitators that can influence implementation, either success or failure. We also intend to develop, test, and refine some relevant theories and conceptual frameworks, and along with them, understand what measures should be used to advance implementation science. So many of you are familiar with the implementation research methods model proposed by Proctor and colleagues, which make the push about thinking about implementation science. On the left side, you see the evidence-based intervention, and on the right side, you see the health outcomes that are being targeted by these evidence-based interventions. But what you don't see typically explained in the research studies are the hows. How did we get that evidence-based intervention into practice? What implementation outcomes did we achieve? And what service outcomes were achieved in the organization that led to these health outcomes? So the focus of this talk is on implementation strategies, which are specifically thought of as the how-to components in this logic model of when we think about evidence-based interventions and achieving health outcomes associated with them. So what are implementation strategies? There have been several definitions in the literature that have indicated a commonality in implementation strategies being specific methods or techniques designed to impact implementation outcomes. For example, let's think of an audit and feedback system that is implemented with providers so that they can understand their own practice and be able to recommend or provide more recommendations for HPV vaccinations. Another example could also be thinking about education and training for nurses and community health workers working in a clinical health center to promote HPV vaccination as well. One of my favorite definitions comes from Jeff Curran's recent article, and he says, implementation strategies are the stuff we do to try to help people or places do the thing. But with these definitions, one can only imagine the overlap and the instability of these terms and recognize that there was a need in the literature to clarify and consolidate a taxonomy. And thus was born the ERIC study, or the Experts' Recommendations for Implementing Change study. What this study did was bring together a group of experts and, using the Delphi technique, generated consensus and collective judgments on what were some specific implementation strategies. This study led to a compilation of 73 strategies. And if you see on your upper right corner, the article has an additional 5-6 that is kind of my go-to resource to understand what we mean by specific strategies. It presents a broader definition of the specific strategies that have been compiled and provides some additional sources from where they were generated. Dr. Waltz and colleagues took this a step further and did a concept mapping exercise to characterize these implementation strategies and assess their feasibility and importance, which resulted in the further categorization into 9 domains. The 9 domains are evaluation and iterative strategies. Think of identifying barriers and facilitators within that. The second one is the interactive assistance. Think of providing facilitation to a practice to help implement a intervention. Adapting and tailoring to context, you could think about tailoring certain strategies to fit a certain implementation context. You could think of developing stakeholder relationships, such as identifying or preparing champions within a setting that could lead the implementation efforts. The fifth domain was the training or educating stakeholders. So as we discussed earlier, conducting ongoing training for some of the staff to implement interventions. You could support clinicians by reminding them through the electronic health record prompts and develop more implementation support for a specific intervention implementation. You could engage consumers, involve them in some of the decision making in how the implementation process should look. You could use financial strategies such as altering incentive structures for promoting certain implementations. You could also think about changing infrastructure, such as mandating change. For example, some school districts have mandated HPV vaccinations. Given these extensive lists of strategies that have been generated through the ERIC study, how would you consider selecting some of these implementation strategies within your research projects? It's always a good idea to think about justifying it based on the context that you are working with, doing a more specific needs assessment, understanding the details of your context. You could also use theory to guide how specific strategies might be important to use in your research projects. And there are 150 or more of them right now in implementation science. You could also consider engaging stakeholders to think about what would be implementation strategies that they would like to use in specific implementation efforts. And last but not the least, consider what practical and empirical evidence you have that could help offer what strategies should be selected. There are specific methods to selecting and developing strategies that have been highlighted in the current literature. And the good old formative evaluation to diagnose what are some of the site-specific needs or the barriers and facilitators. And then use a multidisciplinary team to help interpret some of this data and develop site-specific strategies. You could also think of using implementation mapping that uses a six-step protocol highlighted on the right side of your screen to guide the selection of implementation strategies. And there's a lot more published about this in the literature recently. Some other methods for selecting strategies include concept mapping, which is a mixed methods approach that organizes the ideas of a group through brainstorming to form a common framework, which you can see in the first figure. And in fact, that's what the ERIC study used to come up with those categories of implementation strategies. There is also group model building, borrowed from the systems dynamic literature, which engages a group of stakeholders in identifying and implementing a solution to messy problems. The advantage of this method is that it is informed by stakeholder feedback. We create models for studying the causal loops, as seen in the picture on the right-hand side of your screen, that can help understand the potential consequences of the system structure prior to actual implementation. So it has that distinct advantage of kind of giving you an idea of what would happen if you implemented X versus Y. Lastly, the conjoint analysis also helps measure stakeholder preferences for the intervention attributes. It helps in learning how changes to these attributes may influence implementation. For example, through better acceptability, through better feasibility. And a good primer on these methods is in the reference that is cited on the slide. One of the widely used frameworks to report on implementation strategies was proposed by Proctor and colleagues. And they came up with a set of guidelines for specifying and reporting specific implementation strategies. For those guidelines, they talk about naming the strategy and defining what the strategy encompasses, specifying the strategy under seven domains. Who enacts the strategy, the actor, the specific actions and the steps or processes that need to be enacted. What is the action? Who is the target of this action? Specifying the targets and identifying units of analysis. When is the strategy being used? Temporality. How much of this strategy is being used? How frequently it's being used? The dose of the strategy? What are the specific implementation outcomes affected? And then justification on why specifically these strategies were used, or perhaps even the theoretical justification on why certain strategies were selected for this implementation effort. I'll give you an example of how we used it in one of our studies that was looking at technical assistance as an implementation strategy to promote the uptake of evidence-based interventions, that is EBIs, among state cancer coalition teams for implementing HPV vaccination efforts and colorectal cancer screening efforts in their specific states. When we were thinking about technical assistance, we thought of this as subject matter experts and participants from the state teams meeting in an in-person meeting for 2 days to provide information on existing evidence-based interventions and implementation strategies to really increase the adoption and use of evidence-based interventions in their state action plan. We thought of this being delivered before they actually outlined what their action plan was. And we justified it by some empirical evidence that we had where we noticed that the state cancer action plans were not always using EBIs, and most of the times, in fact, were not aware of the existing evidence-based interventions available. The reference below is a good example to showcase how would you report a specific implementation strategy. There are several resources for strategies to be selected as well. Cochrane does an effective practice in organizations of care systematic reviews that are updated on the website that I've highlighted. Campbell Collaboration has several of these evidence reviews as well. Health systems evidence, and then more specifically in the behavioral science world, the Behavioral Change Wheel by Susan Mishy and colleagues is also available on this slide. One of the newer concepts that we've been thinking about in the literature is to classify strategies based on specific implementation processes. For example, building on the Interactive Systems Framework and Consolidated Framework for Implementation Research, or CFIR, Dr. Lehman and colleagues have thought about classifying strategies, for example, for dissemination or for the specific implementation processes involved, for integration into existing workflow processes, for building capacity, or specifically for scale-up. What this does is it addresses the goal of building practice-level capacity to select, adapt, and implement rather than to begin with a specific intervention in mind. One common way to think about strategies is also thinking about whether they are discrete or bundled. What we mean by discrete is if it's a single action or a process, for example, a reminder or an educational meeting that you might conduct to implement a certain intervention in an organization. There are multifaceted implementation strategies, which are a combination of multiple discrete strategies. So you could think of combining training and then giving some additional technical assistance to help with the implementation of certain interventions. You could also think of these strategies as being blended, which basically is the combination of a number of strategies, but that address multiple levels and barriers to change and are interwoven and protocolized and often branded. For example, the availability, responsibility, and the continuity model, the ARC model, is a good example of a branded, blended strategy. A point to note here is that blended strategies are inherently multifaceted because they use a combination of multiple discrete strategies. However, all multifaceted strategies are not blended, so they may not all be protocolized or they may not all be branded to be a specific model. So let's walk through a quick example of an implementation strategies model. So this was a study recently published to look at community clinics guideline concordant care and whether a specific set of strategies could improve that. It was a three-arm trial with the first arm receiving an implementation toolkit to improve their care. The second arm received a toolkit and an in-person training, as well as a training webinar. And the third arm received all of the above and also an offer of practice facilitation. When they looked at the results of this trial, they were able to show that arm one and two were able to improve their guideline concordant care as compared to no implementation strategies at all. I also wanted to talk about one of the recent tools that have been circulated in the implementation science field is the CFIR-ERIC strategy matching tool. And the link to it is on the upper right-hand side corner of your screen. And the goal of this matching tool was to identify which ERIC implementation strategies would best address the specific barriers that would be highlighted based on a CFIR assessment. So this tool was developed with implementation experts who chose up to 7 strategies that would best address each of these CFIR barriers. But what the authors in the study that I've cited in the slide realized is that there was a lot of heterogeneity in opinions, which indicates relatively few consistent relationships between the specific barriers and the strategies that were chosen. It was really dependent on whether the respondent had prior knowledge of CFIR barriers in that implementation, in a specific implementation context. So having said that, this tool can be an important starting point, but may need to be supplemented more with empirical data from the current process. For tracking implementation strategies, this is an important concept because implementation is complex and dynamic. And in several efforts, you may see strategies that may be applied as barriers emerge. Some of the methods below have been helpful in tracking these strategies in research projects. So for example, you could think about coding implementation team meetings and transcripts or notes, which could allow for the characterization of specific strategies and how they were used in the implementation efforts. You could also think of creating activity logs that could be then completed by project personnel to facilitate the identification of discrete strategies. In one of the forthcoming examples, we are using the exploration, preparation, implementation, and sustainment model to work with the primary investigators of studies to categorize which strategies were used in which of those phases according to the EPIS model. So with that, I'll suggest some future research questions that the field of implementation strategies yet has to answer. We need to do a better job of specifying and testing the mechanisms by which these strategies act towards the specific implementation outcomes. There needs to be a focus on economic evaluations of these strategies in parallel to the push in the field for calculating implementation costs. And we really need to do a better job of thinking about strategies specific to achieving health equity and sustainability and scale up. I'd like to acknowledge the many slides, the many conversations and talks that have been given by Byron Powell and Maria Fernandez and others in this very collaborative implementation science field from which I borrowed many of these slides. With that, I would love to connect with all of you. Shoot me an email or join the Twitter conversation with the hashtag IMPSCI and see you around.